Okay, I'm so glad to end this session with you, actually, because I've been thinking of this moment since we've been exchanging with Christine and with Eric, and what we're going to talk about is really important, huh? Navigating the emotional chaos. I know a lot of entrepreneurs are actually really wondering how to manage emotions for themselves, emotions with their teams, especially during this time. So maybe we could start just by introducing yourself. Christine, what are you doing? What is Butler Health? And what is your main mission?
Sure. So Butler Health is solving the global inaccessibility problem to mental health. So we start off right now by matching people with high quality therapists. Our mission really is to be able to have everyone be able to access mental health, emotional health, and wellness. That's basically what we're after right now.
Okay, so the Butler Health is matching therapists that you've selected mm-hmm. based on certain criteria.
That's right.
With anyone.
That's right. So if someone would fill out a questionnaire, kind of like a quiz, we're trying to make it a little bit lighter, right? You fill out this questionnaire, it asks you a lot of different things because people are looking for having a connection with a therapist is incredibly important, or a counselor. It's more important than anything. And so, you know, you might need someone who's the same ethnicity, cultural background. I'm in LA and I tend to have a lot of people who come in who are film directors or TV directors, and you don't want to retell that story to a therapist. It's hard for them to understand sometimes your background and whatnot. And then we vet out the therapist. So we only bring in high quality therapists to, you know, to match up with individuals.
And more about your background, Christine. So you're a serial entrepreneur. You founded different companies, always in the healthcare insurance ecosystem. And what made you want to focus on connecting therapists with individuals?
Yeah, sure. So my last company was called Joni. And what we did was we simplified buying and using health insurance in the United States for consumers. And one of the things that we learned there is that most of the outreach from our customers was actually around, help me find a therapist. It wasn't around their insurance. Or it was around, you know, finding a doctor in particular, some kind of doctor, but it was not just any doctor. It was like one for me, a good one for me. And that's a very hard thing to figure out. What's good for you? What's good for me? We have different opinions on that. And so when I started this company, I knew that there's a couple things we need. One is, you know, you can choose maybe a random primary care physician. Maybe you can do that and get away with it. You can't choose a random therapist or counselor. That doesn't work. You know, there's no personalization there. There's no trust to be able to start and be so vulnerable with somebody. There's also such a heavy stigma. So if you've never been to therapy, that can be really difficult with someone random all of a sudden. And then the other thing is, it's just really hard to know what a good therapist is, right? There's just no way to really know that. And it's the only industry that's not measured. So, you know, it doesn't do a good job of measuring what happens in that session. And so we're trying, you know, the reason we started this was we knew there was a really big need, and we started this pre-COVID, for just individuals to be able to have help and be able to be heard. And the numbers of anxiety and depression across the globe are ridiculous. And so I think that having a way for to simplify first the process, and then secondly, to be able to actually vet out and know that you're seeing someone who's trusted and vetted is very important when we're finally get the courage to look for somebody.
In France, in a famous magazine, newspaper, they were talking about a psychiatric wave. We'll go back to this. Eric, welcome. Thank you for being here. It's funny because both of you are based in LA, right?
Exactly. And it's 70, the sky is blue, it's sunny. Just making that point.
So finally, the sky is blue.
Because
it's been hard these times with the fires.
You're right.
Okay, Eric, what do you do? What is Sidekick all about? What is your mission?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Alice. And very nice meeting you, Christine. So Sidekick, in few words, is and has been now for more than 3 years the trusted partner for hundreds of employees across three continents. And every of these employees, they feel supported through their professional but also personal growth journey. And we do that by combining coaching at scale. So we provide a very high quality executive coach with technology tools. So we are capable for each employee to give them a personalized response for their unique needs. And when they need it, which is very important, when they need it.
So basically, Eric, you started Sidekick, you're matching coaches with teams, entire teams,
we work for organization, we are contracted with employers, but we work with individuals. And that's very important because as the STEM Christine mentioned, the trust element between the coach and the user is really significant. And besides, Sidekick collects a lot of data on each individual. We do a pulse survey, we analyze their skills, we get their feedback. And all that is absolutely confidential. There is a written audio message conversation or video message conversation between the coach and the user. And therefore, that confidentiality is absolutely critical in order to make sure that everyone feel that when they have that coaching session, they are in that very much safe place when they can self-reflect without being judged. And that's really important on that journey of change that we are all trying to go.
To both of you, I would like to ask you a question. When do I have, as an entrepreneur, as a manager, to tell an employee, or myself, by the way, to go to see a therapist or to find a coach? And how can I integrate this in the process, right? When can I start thinking of it, talking about it, and why as well? It's a lot of questions, I know. Maybe Christine, you can start.
Sure. I mean, I think it's two different parts here. I think entrepreneurs, it's so important to have a coach, incredibly important. And I would say, and I mentor a lot of founders, the first thing I always say to them is that it's a very lonely road. And so you should think about getting a coach that's separate from your mentors, probably within the first 6 months of starting a company. And that seems like very early, but you have no idea, unless you're an entrepreneur, how many ups and downs there are, how much you need to be able to have a safe space to be able to talk about anything you need. And then to also realize that all founders are going through what you're going through. There's no really differentiating within that. We all have hard days and good days. It's a roller coaster. We have all these things. And then I think when you think, and so I, you know, I'll leave the coaching question more to Eric. I can only speak to it because I've been in coaching with a company called Reboot. And so my coach was Jerry Colonna, and he coached me for about 4 years while I was at my last company, and it was incredibly transformational. I ended up at my last company also having their company coach all of my leadership team. And then I started coaching circles with directors and managers as well. And I think what's interesting, I think, is when you think about your employees right now during this time, there is coaching and then there is something a little bit different, which is, you know, usually coaching has more to do with behavioral change. This is, you know, my opinion of what I've gone through, and it's usually at least at a surface level directed at work. It comes up with all sorts of other things that have nothing to do with work, but that's where it starts, and it's heavily reliant on relationships. Therapy, I think, has some of that as well, but it's when you're actually looking for probably something on a different scale and level, right? I think that with therapy, what, you know, I've done both. And I think sometimes there's been a cross where my coach is almost a therapist. Very rarely is my therapist ever a coach. And what I mean by that is a coach will actually tell me what to do at times and give me actual advice, which is a lot of times what you need. A therapist actually believes that you have everything you need. And so they basically help you figure out, you know, behavioral change pieces or whatnot. But as to when I think you should start the journey on therapy, that's a really difficult thing. I think most people start when things are already kind of, therapy in particular, too much, right? And so I think that, you know, my opinion anyway, is that you would start it as you start noticing patterns and wanting to change something in your life. And so, for example, right now with COVID, right? A lot of us are working from home. A lot of us have small kids, or our partners are working with us. You know, not everyone needs therapy necessarily, but everyone certainly needs to talk to somebody about this, right? Now, where I see a lot of therapy here is where the relationship is like, you know, my husband and I are killing each other because, you know, maybe we have little 3-year-olds, 2-year-olds, and we have to watch them and work. And how do we manage that? And so that's a good time to start looking for therapy.
And Christine, during COVID, have you been witnessing some changes in the approach of a therapy? Like, were people more asking for it?
Yeah, it's increased, you know, I mean, like, 5 times what it was before. I think it's talked about more than it was before. I think it's also, you know, I mean, all of us are feeling stress and anxiety. There's no way you're not. The world is upside down. You know, there's people suffering all over the world. We're trying to keep our head up and we're trying to stay focused on what we're doing. It's very hard to do when, you know, I mean, even people who have sort of what they might think are comfortable, safe jobs, it's still in the back of your head, right? Like, you don't know if you're gonna be let go or whatnot. So we've seen it go up a lot. And on our end, the data we've seen is the majority of people are coming in for anxiety and depression. That is the two main things that are coming in. And then the third one comes in for relationships.
All right. Okay. And last question before we switch to Eric is, how do you explain this specific difficulty for the startup people, the CEOs of startup, to open their to start sharing their emotions?
Yeah, I think, you know, founders are naturally startup people. You know, there's a couple things that we share, most of us. One is we're all out to prove something to somebody. The second thing is that we, you know, have strong conviction over what we believe we're building. And sometimes because we have those two things, what we end up doing is thinking we also have to have all of the answers. And that when we see what's going on social media and whatnot, and you see these, you know, what looks like overnight successes, or, you know, people are insanely productive. How are they doing this? You know, we forget that, you know, first of all, those things are ridiculous and not realistic. You know, it's basically what we're seeing. But many of us start to feel defeated or like failures when we're not living up to the expectations of our social norms that are put in front of us. So as an entrepreneur, you're expected in our social norm world to kill it, to crush it, to always have it together, to have a plan, to have it figured out, right? To walk in with a vest, you know, you can take anything. And although all of those things are wonderful, it's that's not how a human operates. And so when you start to realize that and see that all founders really have hard days, good days, are almost running out of money, are making lots of money, it changes all of the time, right? There's very few founders that, and I don't know of any actually, frankly, that start on day one, have it all figured out, and then have this unicorn the next day. It doesn't work that way. And so I think the sooner you're able to actually realize that opening up about these things and just, you know, it doesn't have to be a deep therapy session in that regard, but just on acknowledging that we're not that special, frankly. All of us are going through this. We're all having a difficult time, and COVID makes it even harder. I think we start to feel encouraged when we see peers or someone else that's also sharing these stories. And I really think we have to get away from being founders that frankly pretend that starting a company is easy, because it's not. You wouldn't do it if it was easy. That's part of why you like it too, because it's hard. Yeah.
There is a domino effect. Once you have the first founder in a circle that starts sharing his or her problems openly, then everybody starts talking.
That's right.
Okay, thank you, Christine. Eric, so yes. This is true for therapy. So is it true for coaching? Have you seen a rise in demand?
Yeah, so 3 points to answer your question, Annalise. And I think we have common points with Christine. The first one, coaching, and that's one thing that we've been able to do at Sidekick, is we can make coaching today available to everyone. So currently, as we speak, we have a young customer service agent having a coach, and she works for Mano Mano. We have technology leaders at Tagform, and we have the leadership team, including the CEO for a UK online bank in London. And that's really important to have that in mind, because specifically during the COVID time, and that's my second point, is each of them went through their coaching session, that phase where you move from resistance to resilience, where we help them let go their fears and their frustration on things that they don't control, so they can really focus on the present and what they can control. And that's one of the things that we work a lot at Sidekick, is help everyone to self-manage, so they can act upon their work satisfaction. So that's really something that has been very important. And in terms of overlap that we can have between coaching and therapy, I would say if we can have coaching taking place as early as possible in organization, so you can have very much an open, effective conversation between people, exactly like Christine mentioned, is about relationship. And we are recruited based on our technical skills, but our way of thriving within an organization is our capacity to interact effectively with others. And that's what coaching really helps, is to engage those difficult conversations that we love to avoid because they are difficult. But those difficult conversations, if they are taking place as early as possible, they can stop people going into a mental health issue, a burnout. And that's really one of the challenges that we had during coaching. We address time management, making those choices of work-life balance, being able saying no to your manager, or just asking help to your manager, because you cannot anymore as easily as it was before to really manage your time better when you work from anywhere, as this is the title of that summit. So very much everyone can do coaching. Really, we help them to take control of their life. And you're right, Christine, we start with the working life, but it has an impact on their personal life. So it's so important when you spend 8, 9, 10 hours at work that you can really enjoy those 10 hours. And it will have a positive impact when you get back home, even if you don't leave home, you stay home. And the third point is, yes, coaching is probably early days before that maybe a person at some point needs a therapist. But at some point during a coaching session, I did advise some of my clients to get into a therapy session because the concern was so deep that they needed the help of a therapist.
Every day I have founders asking for good coaches. Every day, and I,
we have 100 coach in the US, in Asia, and in Europe. Whenever
and it works, and it works because the fear is working remotely with a coach or with a therapist, for instance, can be less. It feels less direct and open, and the connection might be less interesting. That's a fear. Okay, so how do you overcome that?
So I'll let Christine to answer on the therapist aspect. So we've been working remotely from day one. We have a coach based in Brisbane supporting customers that we have on the West Coast. I do support employees that are based in Paris or in Warsaw, Poland. So we have from day one work remotely with our client and our coach remotely. So we know and we have developed specific protocols to build that trust. And the way that we onboard the employee, the first session between the coach and the user, we have specific set of questions. We have a specific set of protocol that really help create that bond and that relationship. And we give always the opportunity to the employee to change coach if they want. They know that, so they have that on the back of their mind. So they have that flexibility if they want to implement it. But it happens very rarely. And we give them enough information on the coach. We even give them a 1 minute video of the coach. So for 1 minute, the coach introduced themselves, and hearing the voice, watching the person talking, really helped build that chemistry that is so critical for the success of a coaching partnership.
Thank you, Eric. Christine?
Yeah, one thing I will say is, because there's such a difference between the coaching and the therapy, and I think that's really important to be distinct about it, as Eric said. You know, they're not everyone needs therapy. But one thing, you know, people usually go to therapy because something's happening and they've seen something happen, they need to change their behavior. So, you know, but I think what people miss is you can't really change your behavior without figuring out how to train your mood. So when you regulate your mood, so for example, you know, if I cut myself or step on a nail, and that's very painful, right? I might be able to regulate my mood on understanding that it's painful, but maybe not panic and freak out and make it worse, right? And then by doing that, I might pass out. There's a whole bunch of things that happens with your mood there, right? So, and then that affects the behavior that happens next, my decision making. So training in mood regulation is really helpful for making better decisions, which directly affects your behavior, which if you don't do those two things, you can't really change a relationship that you have. And so usually all of this really ties in. And so in particular, mindfulness therapy as an example, that approach will actually, you know, start to train you on, you know, and we've seen, you know, science behind this. We work with Harvard right now on research around this. And one of the things that's really interesting is, you know, when you when you think about, I want to be happier, what does that mean? What does being happier mean? Well, usually it's a behavioral change you're trying to address, right? But, you know, we know that a couple things. We know that if we study people who are successful, why are they happier? There's a couple of really interesting things that we know about them. One is they have a different, you know, there's a difference between your emotions and your attitude. And your emotions are things like joy and enthusiasm. Attitude is, you know, I can have
a reaction to the emotion.
That's right. So if your attitude, which is pretty much your mood, can be regulated, you tend to be happier overall, even if bad things are happening. You can acknowledge this is a bad thing, this is a bad thought, but I'm not a bad person, and I'm not at the end of my world. So the biggest thing people need help with is mood regulation. And then you can work on the behavioral change pieces of it. And that's where therapy comes in, because then figuring out why is your mood, why is your mood not regulated? How do we change your mood? Not, and you can't do it with a trick. You know, you can't read something and then tomorrow you change your mood. It takes a lot of work and a lot of figuring out, where did this start? When did I start looking at the world this way or at reacting this way? And so that's where therapy is incredibly helpful. And the other thing I think people confuse is we have this stigma around therapy that it has to be around big traumas, right? I had a violent childhood. Maybe I was abused, something like that. But actually, there's a lot more of us that need therapy for little traumas, because those little traumas end up adding up. And so there's small things that actually affected, again, your reaction to, you know, your mood, how you were going to react to a certain event or a behavior or something that happened. And so that's where I think therapy is incredibly important and interesting. On, you know, one of the things that I think is really interesting is we can predict couples who will be divorced. And really, if you wonder, what is the number one sort of trait that, you know someone will have a good relationship? It's, you know, it's not all, people say trust, you know, it's this, it's actually kindness. Kindness is proven to be the number one indicator of a long, healthy relationship. And it's kindness to each other, but also self-kindness. And, but then it's like, how do you train kindness? Can you train kindness and compassion and self-compassion? And that's what therapy starts to dig into, and mindfulness therapy anyway, to start to dig into that.
Well, you know what I see most of the time? It's young founders who are on a honeymoon with their co-founders and everything is going well. And naturally, unconsciously, they are behaving in their best way. They are in their flow, what we call their flow. Super productive, very motivated, always positive, etc. But after a certain period, after this honeymoon period, when you have the real ups and downs and the roller coaster life, and actually something is, there is a scheme often in the company that doesn't work. It doesn't work always and always for the same reasons. And that's when therapy might be related to this problem, actually, because if you don't fix the problem of the founders and it's not just fixing a big trauma, as you said, but maybe just being aware of why they always behave in a certain way or always react in a certain way, they won't be able to go further. And what I see is much more mature entrepreneurs who come and start having really big troubles by not addressing these little traumas accumulated over the time. So I wouldn't recommend to very young, because they don't feel the need yet. Even if, yes, you're right, it would be necessary, but they would feel forced. Maybe this is true when we talk about therapy. Maybe when we talk about coaching, it's easier for them to start implementing the good the ways of working.
Yeah, to agree with both of you. So every 2 weeks, for all employees on a Sidekick app and service, we collect data, and it's 8 statements that we ask them to rate from 1 to 10. It's really, we call that the pulse, and it's really measuring the mood to address the question raised by Christine. And those 8 statements cover everything about learning, transparency, purpose, and 3 of them have a specific weight compared to all of them. And I know as a coach, and we know as a coach, and we have developed protocol for that, that if we work with the employee on those 3 specific statements, they will be happier at work. Those 3 statements are how much my work has a positive impact on the company's goal. So how useful I am, number 1. Number 2 is how am I doing in terms of relationship with my coworkers, and my relationship, number 3, with my manager. So 2 of the 3, it's about working relationship. And if you address those 3 items, if any of those 3 items is on the red zone, as we call that at Sidekick, and if we address those 3 items, you can see the engagement boost after a few weeks, and people very much positive about the future, about their happiness at work. And it's very interesting, as we work with the technology organization on the West Coast, or that was probably before COVID, but in the US, and maybe you will agree with me, Christine, but for a software engineer, it's sometimes easier to resign than to have a difficult conversation with their manager. As finding a job is not an issue, or was not an issue 6 months ago, those difficult conversations, I wanted to avoid them. We help people having those difficult conversations. And 95% of the case, the manager said, well, thank you very much for sharing. No, of course, we're going to review your workload. Yes, we're going to review if you can find a better project where you can get better learning, etc. Those conversations need to take place. And that will help really very much those organizations become more effective. And yes, I really believe it will happen.
One last word, because I see it's already 8 p.m. in Paris. One last word. What would you give as an advice for founders, entrepreneurs who are starting their company during these special times, during a post-COVID era or after lockdown? What would you give them as an advice as an entrepreneur and from your sector point of view?
For, I guess if it's for people that are not starting something new, like, right, that you've already had something, the biggest thing I say is you really need to erase anything you've learned about your business and the world and write it on a piece of paper, throw it into the trash, because none of that applies anymore. So I think you really need to look at the world in a different way and the business in a different way. I also think that from a, you know, I don't know if it's necessarily therapeutic or coaching, I just think, you know, one of the things that we need to do more of right now is to show ourselves more kindness. You know, we put a lot of pressure on ourselves right now, and it's very difficult to do that with everything going on. And so my biggest advice would be that. I don't know that, like I said, you know, not everyone needs therapy. And but everyone at some point in your path needs some kind of help and support system. And you know, and I think being able to acknowledge where you are in your path and finding resources that, you know, align with that. Like, I think it's really incredible what Eric's doing, because it meets you sort of at the beginning of your journey when you need more behavioral change, right? And there are things you can do with a lot of training of patterns to do that. And then there are times, especially right now with COVID, but like, you know, there's obviously people with, you know, all of us, you know, but a big majority of anxiety has gone through the roof. And you know, anxiety isn't solved with behavioral change. And so that definitely needs, you know, therapy, because that comes with first digging into some other pieces of mood first, then behavioral change to figure out, you know, how do I change my decisions about when something occurs? How do I retrain my brain, if you will, right? Mm-hmm. Which is a whole nother ballgame, but that's what I would suggest right now.
Thank you. I took both, everything.
And so I would buy the kindness aspect. I think it's absolutely critical, and specifically for us living here in the US, I think that's it's a very important statement. So I do value that. My advice, and that potentially may answer a question that was asked by some of the attendees, specifically by Rob, I think more communication, more frequent communication, doesn't mean longer, but more checking, and really we have to work more than ever, specifically when we work remotely, we have to work to master our communication skills. And in those communication skills, I have in mind three specific items. One, our capacity to listen, so the active listening. Two, to ask open-ended questions, so that really engage very deep conversation and rich conversation. And three, giving feedback, effective feedback. There's some specific technique based on nonviolent communication, but giving positive, constructive feedback constantly. That really would help to address many of the challenges that we're facing today.
Okay, I take it. I take care of it. Thank you very much, Christine and Eric, for your time. It's been really an interesting session, and I hope it will be helpful for the entrepreneurs watching us. Que la famille.